Dr. Anand, welcome to this program Success Speaks, and lot of congratulations to you for securing All India 62 rank in Civil Service Examination 2018. How are you feeling after getting this wonderful rank?
Thank you, sir, for the wishes. I'm feeling very great and also feeling very blessed that after all my hard work of 4 years and all the blessing of my family and parents have finally paid efforts and I'm able to secure for 62 rank in CSET 2018.
See, when you say finally you got it, it means you have gone for more than one attempt in the past. So I think the audience, those who are now going to try for civil service examination or future aspirants, they would be keen to know about your whole journey about this exam. So how many attempts you have taken?
Sir, it took me around 4 attempts. So first attempt, I was not able to qualify prelims. I missed it by a narrow margin.
Okay.
Second attempt, I secured 371 rank and got IRS income tax.
Income tax.
In third attempt, I went till interview and but was not able to make in the final list. And finally, in the fourth attempt, I got.
You got in that, right? So it means that after getting your selection for IRS, you are under training right now.
Yes, sir.
So you might have taken extraordinary leave, or what?
Yes, I took extraordinary leave.
And then you went for again the fourth attempt.
Yes, sir.
So naturally, this whole grilling. Sake efforts and a lot of experience which you have gathered that would be going to be useful for the future candidates.
Yes,
let me know something about your family background, where from you are, who are your parents, what they do.
Sir, I'm from Agra, Agra district of Uttar Pradesh. My father is a veterinary doctor and he's working with the government of Uttar Pradesh. And my mother is a homemaker and she takes tuitions at home. So she was a professor, she took a voluntary retirement from that and now she takes 2 tuitions at home and also manages home.
So how did this idea of coming to civil services came in your mind?
So there were multiple reasons behind it. So it started with it that during my internship in medical college, I realized that I need a greater opportunity to bring a change in the healthcare system.
Okay.
And health and education being my very close to my heart, so I was looking for opportunities to work in that. And also there were many seniors from my college who were working in the field of civil services. I talked to them and then I decided that this can be the platform to work on my interests.
So it is during your medical college study you formed this idea.
Yes, sir.
See, this is a very natural question even in the civil services interview. And curiosity for many, if at all you had to go for civil services, then why did you join medical? Why not humanities that time?
Sir, actually in 11th, 12th, you are not that much mature enough to decide which interest you have to pursue and what are your interests.
Okay.
So that time being inspired from my father and also my sister, so I went for a medical profession. It's a very noble profession. So for that time I went for medical profession, but during my medical profession, after having exposure to various aspects of and various professions, I realized that I should look for a greater platform, and that during that exposure only I realized that I should go for
it. It means that at the level of 12th, that was the best career option you could understand, and moreover, in place of getting just a graduation degree in any kind of humanities, you preferred to have a professional degree in medical. And of course, now you have become IAS, so before we move into the details of preparation, how you did. So what kind of vision you have in your mind for serving the country in Indian Administrative Service?
Worked to the best of my efforts to address the local needs of the people. But my personal interest lies in the healthcare system and the education system. In order to have to give my whatever efforts I can make to improve the healthcare and the education system of the country, that is my personal interest. But other than that, I will work for the local needs as well.
See, as you have gone through 4 attempts, and of course, it must have been a very, very grueling experience all through. So how do you see this examination? Is it really very tough? Is it easy? Or you have some other word for this exam now to give?
Sir, see, generally my friend used to describe UPSC as an unpredictable public service commission. Certainly there is a level of unpredictableness in that. But I believe it's a mixture of 80% hard work and 20% luck. But for that luck to work, you have to do the hard work. So you cannot totally rely on luck, and hard work cannot be replaced. So you have to do hard work. But what basically understand is, first you have to understand the demand of the paper.
After
what
all,
exactly it demands?
After all, it is said, God helps those who help themselves, yes, right? Sir. Now, see, many people have their in mind that, of course, you have to go through so many attempts to make it there. Some people qualify in the first attempt, some qualify the second, third, fourth, even in the last attempt, maybe sixth attempt also.
Yes.
So, to be relatively confident to qualify in initial attempts, after so much experience, what do you suggest to the future aspirants should be the effort and how a fresher should begin so that there is a certain amount of surety to qualify in the initial attempt itself?
Sir, I'll tell from my experience that why I was not able to clear prelims in the first attempt and what mistakes I made. So, first thing is that you need to understand the demand of the paper. That but go through the syllabus, go through the last year papers, understand that what type of questions are coming, what do you know, and based on that analysis, like for the first prelims I flunked because I didn't know, I was not aware about the syllabus even.
You're right.
I just started preparing by the random books whatever was there in the market and just got went through it.
You but were just preparing subject
just
without
preparing subject,
knowing the syllabus.
Without knowing the syllabus. Mm-hmm. And also a well-planned strategy. Planning is very essential and planning has to be at various level, micro planning, macro planning, both for a day, for a week, for months. A well-planned strategy is very important. Without a strategy and planning, it will be very difficult to clear the exam. So you need to have a proper planning and strategy that what are your sources, from where are you going to study, what are the test papers you are going to solve, what are the tests you are going to give, at what time you are going to give. So I believe that the key is the planning and a well thought out strategy, detailed strategy, which will help you to clear the exam. Without that, it will not be possible.
See, now you have used two basic concepts here and which you also always frequently tell the candidates, because when you're going to appear in this examination, you should know in detail, rather you should go frequently to study your syllabus. UPSC takes a lot of time to frame a syllabus and they have a purpose behind the yes. syllabus. But this common mistake is the students, they don't bother to go through the syllabus and the basic guidelines of syllabus. They start simply jumping into the subject study and take voluminous books and they end up nowhere. This is what you felt also there.
Yes.
So the audience, those who are watching you, they should be very clear on this point here, that UPSC has given a scientifically designed syllabus. So you should sufficiently spend time to understand whatever the subjects have been prescribed within the subjects, what are the different topics, modules, where is the focus of the examiner, and then accordingly you can start your study.
Yes,
the second thing you said, you must have strategy of your own, right? So this strategy is always going to be individual. Of course, the basic objective of this particular program, the success speaks, is also the same.
Yes, sir.
That to let the student understand that every candidate has his or her own strategy. But of course, you can get reference from the previous toppers and the successful candidates. But you can make one which suits to you. That is very important there. So now let's discuss a bit on this particular thing. When the syllabus comes, just let's understand in brief. What did you do with the understanding of syllabus, which you would like to share with others?
So first thing, what I started with is download the syllabus
mm-hmm.
and the last 5 years of prelims and mains paper.
Very
I gave good. Around 1 week for that mm-hmm. to understand how what type of questions are coming, how much is the form of the syllabus, in what order are they coming.
This you did in the second attempt.
Yes, second
first
attempt. First attempt, I was not. In the second attempt, I started with this.
Right.
Downloaded the syllabus, downloaded the 5 year papers and gave around what 7 to 10 days to understand the whole syllabus. And to be specific, to memorize the syllabus so
right.
that I'm aware what I have to study and what I have not to. I don't have to study. Then spend time on understanding the papers. Then after that, I started with having that jot down my sources. That this topic I'll study from this topic I do. The for the whole syllabus, for each and every topic, I was aware about my sources. That this will be my sources. And I repeat, have single source. Then and multiple revision
rather than having
multiple sources there without any revision.
So now one thing is clear, that syllabus has to be taken. You went to the extent of memorizing that, so that is always in your mind. Secondly, by referring to the previous year's questions, you got guideline. Okay, what is the scope of questions? How the questions are being framed, so that when you study that segment of syllabus, you know what could be the possible range of questions asked in the question.
Yes.
And the third thing, identifying the source. So in place of having multiple sources, you should preferred to revise from one source time and again. Now, let's talk about the initial source, which most of the candidates, even we guide always, that you should start with NCERT books,
yes.
Right? You might also have done the same thing.
Yes.
So, now the question is how to begin the study for NCERT. Some students have questions, should they study old NCERT or they should study the new NCERT? What do you have to say on that?
I have gone with the new NCERTs only. They are, I believe that they are more updated one. And the things change with time to time. So the new NCERTs are much more a reference book for me. And I also advise to go for the new ones.
This is a very clear concept, because there is unnecessary confusion, old or new. When the books have come well revised in the new version, it is better to do that. But to understand any particular topic, if it has been elaborated in previous, so there is nothing wrong to see that also. The second thing is, from which standard to which standard? This is another question which comes in. What do you have to say on that?
Well, sir, for that, I personally believe that it has to be a person-specific approach. First, you have to understand what are your basics. For like, I started with around a 10th, 11th, 12th NCERTs because I had a good basics and awareness about it. But if you personally feel that your basics are not that strong, then I think you should start from 8th. That will be.
It depends on the subject in which you are more prepared or you are less prepared.
Yes.
If you don't have background, you can pick up the book upon 6th level itself,
yes,
and go otherwise. How many times you read NCERT books?
Specifically, the book which I made a reference for the long term. Some books were helpful in understanding and they were not the reference books. And some were my reference books like geography NCERTs, history NCERTs, economic NCERTs.
So time and again you were going through the pages.
Yeah. So that NCERTs, I'm 7 to 8 times, I personally believe.
See, this is wonderful thing to understand. Sometimes students do the mistake. They feel that it is 10 plus 2 books, so one reading is enough.
Yes, sir.
Whereas when you read second, third time, you find more and more insight and understanding about the whole subject there.
Yes.
And preferably there should be underlining,
yes,
and if in the space some brief notes can be made, that is also, I think, welcome. You would,
yes,
you would appreciate that,
yes,
right?
Yes, sir. I used to.
How to read NCERT book is a question, because people might take it lightly, they may not understand that. So I think discussing a few minutes on that will also help. So what do you have,
sir,
to suggest?
One key to read NCERT is that every word of NCERT and every line of NCERT is itself a question,
mm-hmm,
that can come in UPSC, be it in prelims, be it in mains. So every line you have to understand it. Every line says a lot.
Mm-hmm.
There might be 4 words, but it might have an explanation of 400 words. So for that, you have to read it thoroughly. Every line you have to understand again and again. If you don't understand, go for some explanation videos all around, or maybe old NCERTs. But I mean to say is that every NCERT, for the first attempt, you go through the read and read the whole NCERT. And eventually you'll understand that with every reading, you'll get a new perspective.
Yes, that is the
new aspect you'll get it. So my key is at least give 6 to 7 readings to NCERT. So that eventually you'll be able to realize that you have a better understanding.
And is it in the first go itself you will say 6-7 reading, or you say that when you evolve with some more study and later on you come back again to repeat that?
Yeah, see, earlier I was also not aware that I'll have to go for 7-8 readings of NCERT. But when I realized, I flunked in my first attempt and then I matched the question. They were directly from NCERT. Similarly, in the second attempt, the questions came. Then I realized that every line of an NCERT is itself a question for UPSC. And for that, every line to understand and to remember, you need a multiple readings.
So that's the concept here, that UPSC takes NCERT books as a major source or any government source, a as a major source for the question also. So it is advisable to the students in the beginning itself, for the beginners, that they should go through the syllabus very thoroughly. They should go through the previous year questions, and then they should take the initial studies from NCERT books and related books that way. In the strategy preparation, how much time you give to think over whatever you read? Did you apply enough time to think and correlate subjects for that?
Yes, sir. So, though my planning, whatever plan I used to have for a day, so what I used to do is that, suppose I have a plan of 8 to 10 hours of a study, so which means eventually I will effectively study for 7 to 7 and a half hours, and for day around 2 hours, that will be my thinking process. And that 2 hours is what distributed over the day. Like, for example, I feel bored while studying and I have to go for lunch. So I'll take 15 minutes, just walk around and think over whatever I have read. Similarly, while I'm traveling from one place to another, that time I used to utilize for thinking. Or maybe on the dinner time, I used to, like dinner or lunch, what I used to do is, I don't understand some topic. So I was thinking about it and I was not able to understand. I'll search for some video about it. So I define this time as voids. So whatever the voids is when you are traveling somewhere, or you are having your lunch, you are having your dinner, or sometimes you are in bathroom. So that time I used to utilize for thinking whatever I have read or what I have not been able to understand.
So this is basically for the future aspirants to understand, which I always emphasize on, read and think and write. So you must have enough time. Rather, when you finish your study, if you remain focused, a lot of in the back of mind, you have something always going, so you should process. Mind takes time to process whatever you read that. And then writing.
Yes, sir.
You also practice that.
Yes, sir.
Whenever you got time, you have to note down the points, recall that.
Yes,
reading, thinking and writing. If these things are taken in a proper balanced way, then you can have real depth of that.
Yes, sir.
Here is a question which I would like to ask you. Why UPSC asked or he has suggested to read so many subjects? What is the purpose of that?
So, see, UPSC, one of the thing is that there are multiple services which is going through the UPSC,
mm-hmm.
you have to get through. And as an administrator, you need to be aware about all the things.
Right.
Say people look up to you for the solutions. If you're not aware about, for example, there was a debate going on between my friend that what is the purpose of having a irrigation as a topic in UPSC? So, I like the answer which one of my friend gave. Ki suppose if you are posted as a district magistrate in a district, and one of a farmer comes that I am facing this problem, can you help me in providing the solution? But if you are not aware about the irrigation types, so if you are not aware, how will you look for solutions? Before going for specialist, you need to have a
generalist understanding.
So that is why the syllabus is so diverse and so was a very well thought syllabus.
And basically one more important reason is to develop multiple perspective, because you might be a student from science background,
yes.
humanities, or maybe from commerce, any discipline.
Yes.
But after a point of time, you might get specialized.
Yes, sir.
Whereas in civil services, when you take a decision, you think about any solution,
yes.
you have take from holistic perspective,
broader perspective,
which is also, you can say, lateral thinking. You're talking about your problem, any solution. You think from economics, you think from politics,
society,
you think from society, you think from science and technology. In one matter, you can have several such concepts coming there.
Yes.
So it is basically developing a wide range of thinking and solution for that. This is right.
Yes.
Here, just we have to take a break, Anand, then we'll continue our discussion.
Yes.
Right? That is all.
Hello, this is Junaid Ahmed, and my experience with Chanakya for my mock interview was really good. I met the board, they were very experienced, and the kind of questions they asked were very diverse. The questions they asked were from DAF plus current affairs, so they gave a holistic idea of the kind of questions that may be asked in my interview. Plus, apart from the questions, the things which they focused upon was the presentation, how you need to present yourself in front of the interview board. So your verbal, non-verbal traits which are there, your sitting posture, the way you enter, and all these things, they also play an important role during your interview. So the suggestions which were there regarding this, they were also very helpful. I wish Chanakya and its team all the best, and I hope in the future also they'll keep helping the future aspirants in getting their goal. Thank you.
Welcome back. Dr. Anand, we are talking about this whole strategy of preparation. So we just discussed about how to begin the study and also the preparation strategy from NCERT box. Now let's talk what is the correct and right way to prepare for preliminary examination. You could not qualify in the first attempt, but in all the next three attempts you qualified in the pre, and finally you are here with All India's 62nd rank.
Yes.
So what do you think would be a sure shot or correct way of preparing for preliminary examination? What do you have to say for that?
Sir, for the prelims, I divided the prelims into two parts. So one is the static portion and one is the dynamic portion for it. Static, you have standard books with you. And for the dynamic, it's the current affairs, international organization, then the reports and the map-based questions.
Yeah, reading will discuss that when it's just a question. Okay, for any beginner, a fresher, who is going to appear first time in the examination. So we going to, what would be the study? First off, let us discuss, is it the separate preparation which you will suggest, pre and main separately, or you would suggest integrated preparation?
I would suggest an integrated preparation.
Correct. So that is the most relevant way to prepare for the examination, because most of the question, syllabus part is common also in pre and mains.
And mains preparation gives you a more broader and holistic perspective views. So your knowledge base and your horizon also get widened, which helps you.
So what I can understand from your experience is that although you are preparing for pre, but you always have to make an integrated preparation for mains and pre both. And you should read, keeping mains in mind, but you should have some clarity about what kind of question asked in the pre-examination. So we would like to discuss something about the pre, especially the pre. What is the expectation of the examiner in the pre-examination? What are the basic factors you think an examiner is testing in the pre?
See, fun thing is the examiner is testing is the general awareness. Mm. That how much are you aware about the general, see if you look at the current affairs question, there must be 20 to 25 questions which are only on the general awareness base. Okay, this place which is very famous currently, suppose for example, South Sudan was famous for the conflict. So they might ask, this place is located in which country?
Mm-hmm.
So the general awareness, that how much regularly are you generally aware about the incidents happening in the country and outside the country. Then the basic understanding, not just very in-depth knowledge, the basic understanding of all the subjects like history, geography, polity, and specifically in polity like your parts which are the foundation of the constitution, fundamental rights, DPSP, fundamental duties, focus on these areas. Similarly, on history, the focus on the independence movement.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So these areas, then geography about Indian geography, map-based questions, and then the international organization related questions.
How much is relevance and importance is to the current affairs in preliminary examination?
So it has changed with every year's question, but I believe that it has to be given equal importance as you give to the static portion.
Right.
Because you are not aware which type of paper it will be, a current affairs dominated or a static dominated. And many a times, even the current affairs are based on the static portion.
Right. Current, of course, has some the other relation with the static portion always.
Exactly.
Right.
So I think equal weightage should be given to both the paper, and you should be prepared for both. So as we say that more you sweat in peace, less you bleed in the war.
Right. That is wonderful concept which you are using. Let's take a segment wise in the preliminary examination. There are different segments like history of India and also the culture part of that. We have also Indian constitution and polity and economy and such subjects. Where in history, the subject, where is the focus of the examiner? In the ancient, medieval, modern, or in culture? Where do you find with your experience of last?
Modern history has been significantly important for the prelims exams.
Right.
There are around 7 to 8 questions generally from the modern history.
Right.
And it's much more objective. So approach should be that to have a better understanding of modern history.
Mm.
And then the weightage could be given to medieval, ancient or the art and culture.
But even ancient and medieval, is it focused on political history or the cultural economy? Do you find it more focused on that?
more on the cultural aspect.
Cultural aspect. Art and culture would be, I think, more and more important. So what the students would understand is, like this, in the history of India, they must have a fundamental study of the entire in history of India, maybe from the NCERT books.
Yes, sir.
But there should be some focus more on the art and culture, maybe administration, economy,
yes,
right, like that. And especially in modern India.
Yes, sir.
That is very going to be important.
Yes,
right. So, what books do you suggest to read for history for the preliminary examination?
Basics is NCERT, I'll go for. Then what I have read is Spectrum, but some people go for Vipin Chandra also. So that is your individual call. If you want to have a good time, if you have enough time, so then you can go for Vipin Chandra also.
So it is possible that you should read some fundamentals books, and then also you can improvise on, like reading Indian Independence Movement by Bipin Chandra and such kind of books also there.
Yes, sir.
Regarding geography as subject, world geography, which is the question, where is the focus of the examiner in world geography?
More on the Indian physical geography.
Mm-hmm.
That the focus has been on the Indian physical geography, the related to the climate, vegetation, or the physical forms around the country. So for that, I think NCERT is will it suffice.
Which from which to which standard you feel?
I've focused on four NCERTs of 11th and 12th, two NCERTs of 11th and two NCERTs of 12th.
That you found is enough,
yes,
to take care of the, and there would be always a some support from the current affairs,
okay,
if any incident or anything has happened.
Geographical location of the
so
areas.
That will be serving the purpose for geography portion of that. What about the constitution and Indian governance part?
See, sir, the standard book generally people follow is the Lakshmikant, and the part one of the Lakshmikant, the like fundamental duties, preamble, fundamental rights, directive principle, these are parliamentary procedures. These chapters forms around 70% of the polity questions.
Okay.
So, the focus should be on these questions.
And which source you find will be relevant for that?
I will prefer, if you go on Bear Act, then it's the best thing to do. But I prefer the Lakshmikant.
Okay. Anyway, whichever, I think, whether it is going to be Lakshmikant or any book which is relevant, which any candidate can understand. Some people study Subhaskar's
also. From D.D. Basu also. Yeah,
so
that is an individual.
Idea is that if you are careful about the syllabus segments and also previous question,
yes,
and whichever book you feel you can release to study, you can go through that. But you must be able to remember,
yes,
retain most of the things there, right? And what about gender science and science and technology? Do you feel the question is more on the traditional type or it is more on the application side?
The both type of questions have been coming. For traditional type, like on the basis which of the following is a chemical reaction, something related to biotechnology, but as well as the application like the science program, the space program, the missile program of the country, nuclear program of the country, these questions have been coming. So I think it's a mix of both, but more on the application part is much more important than the basic.
And what source do you suggest for gender science and science and technology to read?
I had a little different approach for science and technology. I used to focus on the current affairs portion, as well as what I used to do is to go on the websites of this thing. Like for the nuclear program, I used to go on the official website for that. For the space program, I used to go for ISRO's website.
Mm-hmm.
Like for these programs, I used to go for the official website and gather data from there.
So government sites, especially for the concerned departments, of course, you must have been very aware and,
yes,
conscious about what things are going on.
Yes,
so it's a question of sources are quite lot, but you have to go for relevant sources.
Relevant.
And it is better to go for the government sources.
Government
that will be more authentic on that.
Yes.
And how do you have more of traditional type question in general science?
Now I think application-based questions
application-based
are more
based there.
Yeah.
There is a section ecology and environment also.
Yes, sir.
Which sometimes become very difficult for the students. What is the focus of examiner in this segment of syllabus?
The focus has been much more on the relevant aspect going in the current affairs portion. Earlier, there used to be some questions based on the static portion. But now the current, like which climate change is happening, which events are happening, for the Paris climate change event is happening, or if is there any development regarding to any summit is happening, or some aspects of what damage is being caused to that area, or what are the pollutants, new pollutants is rising. So I think the more on the application based, especially based on the current affairs.
Okay, that
you can focus on the current affairs portion.
But to those who do not have background of such subject, what kind of book they should read?
NCERT.
these things are covered by the NCERT also, ecology, and environment.
Yes.
Is there any specific book on ecology there?
Yeah, 12th biology. The whole second half of the book is on the ecology.
Ecology. And what about the environment section?
That covers both.
That is also in the biology part?
Biology part.
Okay, it's there.
And plus, what you can do is go on the Ministry of Environment. There's an annual report by the ministry. So, in month of, I think, May or June, they comes with the report of annual report. You can just have just an overview of that report. It's a very good report.
That's very good. So, basically, going to the authentic source, government source, that can be again relevant for ecology and the environment for that all there. Now, what do you think about economy section, Indian economy? Because those people who do not have background of economy, how much of economics is required in this subject?
I think the basic understanding of economics, which a layman could understand, specifically while reading the newspapers, or the general understanding of the economics is much more sufficient for the paper.
Particularly the economic terms which are quite frequently used, one should be clear about that, basic terms of that.
Inflation, MSP, all these aspects.
These things keep appearing in the newspaper also. Right. But there should be some fundamental clarity. So I think NCERT level book of Indian economy should also be sufficient for that.
Yes.
Right. And then of course, more and more practice on the question would help. Right. That. So this way, I think the audience would be in a position to understand where they should focus in pre. Of course, the approach has to be integrated.
Yes.
But when you are keeping in mind a pre, there should be focus on the facts, figures, the basic concepts.
Yes.
And a very important thing is retention
yes.
of relevant facts. How to remember the relevant facts, conceptual clarity, and then also acumen to select best of the given option.
Yes.
This is normally when you go in job, you have always some options there, but according to situations, what best option are you going to choose? And even the preliminary examination, this is the same thing examiner is asking. They are giving the guidelines in the question and then asking which is the best possible option that way, right? The one important thing which comes in mind to the student is they say that, okay, they will forget after some time. It's difficult to remember. So, what did you do for that?
For that, I used to have a periodic revisions.
That's very good.
Like, doing
how frequently do you did the revision?
At least 3 weeks or 4 weeks.
At least.
I used to.
Rather, it could be ideal that every week that you have some time.
Yes, that depends upon. See, the revision used to depend on what subject I am doing it. If I am very good at some subject, then the revision was less frequent. If subject was which I am not very strong at, then the revision was more frequent.
And I think you would also suggest that there should be some brief notes on the material, not very elaborate notes, but those you can use your codification to remember these all things there. And after all, there are a lot of practice on the questions. So, test series and test practices.
At least 50 to 60 papers for the prelims you need to do.
So, if I ask you to give three most important things to take care for civil services preliminary examination, what will you say?
One thing is don't be overconfident. Don't think that this exam is going to be an easy one for you. I believe that prelims is the most difficult exam out of the three.
Right. Why did you say that?
Because the number of candidates who are appearing
very large, and the
selections are very less, and plus at even with the 1 marks difference, it's going to cost.
And after all, it is screening test.
So
you can be screened out.
Yes. So you can be screened out easily. Second thing is practice as much as possible. Practice around 50 to 60 papers with your comfort, because see, eventually in around paper out of 100, you'll be aware about the 60 to 65 questions surely.
You're right.
Rest 20 to 25 is more on the guesswork, smart work, smart guessing in the acumen, and that acumen you can develop only by practicing.
Correct, right.
And third thing which I keep on saying is don't go for multiple sources. Have a single source, do multiple revisions. Have a single source.
Limit your sources, but do it with more clarity.
Clarity with more repetition.
And what about the examination skill on the day of exam? When you solve the paper in the examination hall, what precautions has to be taken for that?
The 2-3 precautions is don't panic. If you don't know starting 3-4 questions, shift to another page. If the question paper is going to be difficult for you, then it's difficult for everyone. So don't panic just because you don't know 4-5 questions.
Right.
Keep yourself calm. Think, read the question at least twice or thrice before marking it. because there is a words game they have been playing for the last 2-3 years. So read it at least twice or thrice before marking it. Keep yourself calm and at least do 2 readings of the papers. Like in first attempt, solve the question which you have been able to do. In the second attempt, then go for again one more reading so that you are sure before marking the answers. And also before the exam, don't try to study everything. Focus on more important parts so that and maintain your calm there. Focus on the important parts, just go through the headings, just go through the important aspects and go for the exam with the positive attitude. Because my first attempt was fun. One is the lack of knowledge and second is the anxiety. The 3-4 questions I was not able to solve, I got anxious that now I will not be selected. You don't know.
You have 100 questions and anyway you are not going to just to make solve all the questions there. Definitely
score 50% marks.
Right.
You'll get through. So keep yourself calm in the exam. That is the most important key, I believe.
The idea is that you have to go through all the questions and keep trying with the same amount of seriousness and patience on the entire. And what do you have to say about CSAT? Because although it is qualifying in nature, but this year's paper is showing that it is going to be tough more and more with the time there. So, how one should get ready for CSAT?
Sir, I believe that you go for at least last 5 years' papers.
Right.
Solve them and at least 1 month before the exam, start solving for half an hour. What I used to do is, I used to give half hour to 45 minutes 1 month before the exam. So that my mind is prepared for all that. I have, there's a whole thing is going on the GS. Suddenly you have to shift from maths to English. That takes time. You don't have to do that. You are doing it first time in the CSAT paper only, in the UPSC exam only. So 1 month before the exam, I used to solve CSAT papers for around 45 minutes per day. So like 5 to 7 years papers, that will help you out in solving.
I hope your inputs on preliminary examination and also the startup preparation will help a lot to the beginners and also those who are struggling for success this time. Related to the mains examination and other there. Yes, but at the moment, I think this should be fine. And I hope the audience would be able to take the best out for the starting and also for the prelims study. So thank you very much for joining me today and the best for that.
Thank you. Subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon to get latest updates on upcoming videos.